So broad spectrum antibiotics. So regarding broad spectrum antibiotics, I'm going to explain on what is broad spectrum antibiotics, what are the difference between other types of antibiotics, indications for use of antibiotics, this broad spectrum antibiotics with examples and their dose. Okay, I'm sure every one of us has written prescriptions of broad spectrum antibiotics, and because we are constantly using that, many of us has forgotten their exact indication for use and also the duration or the exact dosing. Okay, so in that sense, this broad spectrum antibiotic, class 1 broad spectrum antibiotics is very important, and also it can be asked as short notes for both postgraduate and undergraduate examination. So what is this broad spectrum antibiotic? So we know there are two types of bacteria or cocci, whatever it is. We have both the gram positive and gram negative organisms. Tell me an example of gram positive. Yes, staph aureus or streptococcus, they are all gram positive. And an example of gram negative is E. coli. Okay, E. coli. We every one of us know that E. coli is gram-negative bacteria. Okay, so this broad-spectrum antibiotics will act on both these gram-positive as well as gram-negative organisms. Okay, so broad-spectrum antibiotics will act on both gram-positive and gram-negative. So, if there is a broad-spectrum, what are other types of antibiotics? There is a narrow spectrum antibiotic, and also there is an extended spectrum. Okay, so there is extended spectrum also, right? So there is narrow spectrum antibiotics are there, extended spectrum antibiotics are there, and broad spectrum is there. So broad spectrum will act on both gram positive and gram negative. Narrow spectrum will act on specific one. They will act on gram positive. Okay. And this extended spectrum will act on gram positive and some of the gram negative organisms. Right? But broad spectrum will act broadly, wide acting, both on gram positive and on gram negative. So to understand that, let me ask you, what is the basic difference between a gram negative and a gram positive bacteria? So, what is the basic difference between a gram-positive and a gram-negative bacterial morphology or structure? Both has got a cell membrane, isn't it? And over the cell membrane, they have got a cell wall. So, you know, this gram-positive bacteria has got a thicker cell wall and gram-negative bacteria has got a thinner cell wall, isn't it? So, the cell wall is made up of this sugar backbones. Made up of sugar backbone. This sugar, otherwise called glycan, and connected by peptide links. Okay, glycopeptide or peptidoglycan links. They are connected by peptide links. Isn't it? And this gram negative has also got a sugar backbone connected by peptide links. Isn't it? So both has got glycopeptide or peptidoglycan cell wall. And if the gram positive has got a thicker cell wall, this antibiotic which penetrate this should penetrate this thin cell wall also, isn't it? Then logically all those are affecting or attacking this gram positive bacteria should attack gram negative also. Then why this all gram positive are not attacking gram negatives? That is because this gram negative bacteria has got a outer coating over this cell wall. It has got an outer coating. And this outer coating is not present in a gram-positive bacteria. And in this cell wall, they have got pore, big pore through which this antibiotics can come and attach to the cell membrane and cause deactivation of this bacteria. They have got very big pores. So once again, this both has got a cell membrane, and outer to the cell membrane they have got a cell wall which is made up of peptidoglycan rings. And this cell wall in case of gram positive is bigger, but it has got very large pores through which this narrow spectrum antibiotics can enter and they can get attached to the cell membrane. But gram negative bacteria, even though it has got a thinner cell wall, it has got an outer coating or an outer covering, and this outer covering has got very small openings. Isn't it? What is it called? They are called porins. Okay, porins. So that an obese antibiotic will not enter into this gram negative bacteria. Okay, so this narrow spectrum antibiotics will not come and act against this gram negative organisms. So because they have this porins are very small pores on the outer coating, and this obese antibiotics cannot cross enter into the gram negative cell membrane. So that is why this broad spectrum antibiotics will come and attach to both this, or they are active against both gram positive and gram negative organisms. Okay, now let us see the indications of use of this broad spectrum antibiotics. Usually we give broad spectrum antibiotics as empiric therapy. Empirical therapy. Okay, and this narrow spectrum is usually given for a definitive therapy. So let me ask you, what is empirical therapy? What is definitive therapy? Then we can easily understand what is an empirical therapy. What is definitive therapy? This definitive therapy is when we know the exact pathogen causing the disease. The pathogen is isolated, or we know what organism is causing the disease, so that we can give the correct antibiotic for that. When there is no evidence, or when the pathogen cannot be isolated, or when the exact organism causing the disease is not known, like in an ICU setting, or when there is a very high grade infection and we cannot wait for starting the antibiotic, in such cases we give broad spectrum antibiotics. Okay, so that is called an empirical therapy, and this empirical therapy should be started only after getting a culture or any other swab or something, and that should be sent for microbiological study. For example, if the patient has come with an extensive retropharyngeal abscess or an infection of the throat, first we have to take a culture from the throat swab for culture and sensitivity, send that to that throat swab for culture and sensitivity to your laboratory, then start on a broad spectrum antibiotic, and you have to change to the definitive therapy once you get the results of this culture and sensitivity. How will you know that which antibiotic has to be started as empirical therapy? That we get from previous experience of the clinician, or from evidence from literature, or based on clinical diagnosis. Okay, so based on clinical diagnosis, or from the experience of the treating clinician, or from evidence from the journals, we can start empirical therapy for that specific disease. Okay, and now we can see what are the examples of this narrow spectrum, extended spectrum and broad spectrum antibiotics. So these are the examples of these three types of antibiotics. Narrow spectrum is mainly coming the penicillins, the natural penicillin, that is penicillin G and penicillin V. And I already told you that gram positive bacteria has got a very thick cell wall, but this cell wall has got very wide or large openings in that. So that even the obese penicillins can go through that and can attach into the cell membrane. And bacitracin and clindamycin are also coming, and these are mainly against gram-positive organisms. Natural extended spectrum is mainly aminoglycosides and fluoroquinolones. Of the aminoglycosides, the commonly used in ENT is gentamicin. Gentamicin given in a conventional dose of 3 to 5 milligram per kilogram body weight, in divided doses at 8th hour can be given IV or IM. Okay, so gentamicin, but it causes ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, and also neuromuscular junction blockade. And this is mainly acting about gram negative organism. Okay, there are also minocycline, kanamycin, like that, very number of aminoglycosides are there. And in fluoroquinolones, there comes norfloxacin, levofloxacin, ciprofloxacin. And in ENT, we often use ciprofloxacin, mainly for otological diseases, otological conditions. It is ciprofloxacin. Ciprofloxacin. Oral preparations are there, IV preparations are there, and also ophthalmic solutions are there. And in ciprofloxacin is mainly effective against gram-negative organism, including pseudomonas and also some gram-positive, especially staph aureus and some of the atypicals. So orally we give, we can give 100 milligram, 200 milligram or 500 milligram tablets are there. And for IV preparation, there is 200 and 400 milligram. Usually we give IV preparations at the 12th hourly intervals, and there are also ophthalmic solutions. So oral adult dosage is 500 milligram tablet we give as BID, and for IV preparation it is we give 200 or 400 milligram IV twice daily after test dose. Okay, and the complications like severe GAT problems like nausea, vomiting, then it can also cause QT prolongation. So, and also in growing cartilage, it has got, can damage the growing cartilage causing arthropathy. Though it is reversible, if this ciprofloxacin or other fluoroquinolones are usually not given in children and in also pregnancy. Okay, and also in cases of seizures and in patients of QT prolongation, this fluoroquinolone, especially ciprofloxacin, is contraindicated. So it is not ideal for children and in also pregnancy. In children, it can cause damage. Though temporary, it can cause damage to the growing cartilage, later leading to arthropathy. Okay, so ciprofloxacin is not given in children and also in pregnancy. Right, then coming to our topic, which is broad spectrum antibiotic. We can give amoxicillin, usually in combination with clavulanic acid. Amoxicillin and ampicillin are actually penicillin group, but they are newer penicillin, very slim penicillins, so that they can penetrate through the porins of gram-negative bacteria. Okay, I already told you the cell wall has got an outer covering, and it contains porin, which are very small openings. And this amoxicillin and ampicillin can go through this porin. They are so slim, so that they can travel through the porins and can affect the gram-negative bacteria. So, and their action is modified by clavulanic acid and also tazobactam, because they are beta-lactamase inhibitors. So this combination is very good and very highly preferred in our ENT setup. Okay. Amoxicillin clavulanic acid combination, or ampicillin tazobactam, or piperacillin tazobactam. Then tetracycline, chloramphenicol and trimethoprim, and sulfamethoxazole combination, the so-called ceftran, and also sulfonamides. They are all broad spectrum antibiotics. Okay, so this amoxicillin clavulanic acid is a highly used or highly preferred combination in ENT. Trade name as Augmentin or Amoxiclav. They are all widely used in ENT. So it is available in pediatric and also in adult form. Pediatric oral suspension, usually we give 125 milligram amoxicillin plus 31.25 milligram of clavulanic acid, or 250 to 62.5 milligram combinations are there for oral preparation. We give usually to, thrice daily dosage, and tablets are available in 250 amoxicillin and 125 clavulanic acid, 500 or 125, or there are extended release capsules of 1000 milligram and 125 milligram. And this can be given 8th hourly or 12th hourly. Usually for the first line therapy for all types of acute sinusitis, then lower respiratory infections, for all we give this amoxicillin clavulanic acid is preferred as an empirical therapy. But the all the complications of empirical therapy, especially the multiple drug resistance, especially Clostridium difficile associated diarrhea, is very common with this amoxicillin clavulanic acid combination. So you should be cautious about that. This one of the major side effect or the risk of this broad spectrum antibiotic is that it will also damage the natural inhabitants of your gut, so that there is multiple drug resistance and also an altered the internal environment in the GAT can also occur. So there will be more chance of diarrhea. So you should be very cautious in giving that. The indications should be, already I told you the indication, that should be very carefully sought to, and you have to change to definitive therapy once the reports of concern and sensitivity has been available from the laboratory. And another commonly used antibiotic is ampicillin. Usually ampicillin sulbactam combination is preferred more than ampicillin, because this sulbactam or clavulanic acid all will inhibit the beta-lactam producing bacteria, so that the spectrum of activity of this amoxicillin or ampicillin is extended. Okay, beta-lactamase inhibitors. So ampicillin is usually given 250 to 500 milligram tablets are available, or it can also be given as IV or IM injections, 50 to 250 milligram per kilogram body weight per day. You can give for 4 to 6 hours. And the total dose should not be more than 12 gram per day. Okay, this is the maximum permissible dosage of ampicillin. And if we are giving ampicillin plus sulbactam combination, this is available, not available oral preparation. The dose of this ampicillin sulbactam, this is not available orally, only injections are available. Usually 1.5 gram, 3 gram and 15 gram. So ampicillin and half the dose of sulbactam is half of that of ampicillin. If it is 1.5, then it is 1 plus 0.5 gram. That is 1 gram ampicillin and 0.5 of sulbactam. 15, then it will be 10 plus 5. And for 3, it will be 2 plus 1. 2 of ampicillin and 1 of sulbactam. This is usually given for 4 to 6 hourly, and ideally we give it for 7 days. Okay, injection. The drug of choice for Pseudomonas aeruginosa presently is piperacillin-tazobactam combination. And this piperacillin-tazobactam, I already told you, is highly effective against Pseudomonas aeruginosa. They are available in vials. Okay, vial. For injection, that is 2 gram per 250 milligram, or 3 gram per 75 milligram, or 36 gram per 4.5 grams. And usually infusion given over a period of 30 minutes for against Pseudomonas aeruginosa infections. And also there are cephalosporins and azithromycin. They are also broad spectrum antibiotics. So now you know how this broad spectrum antibiotic, mechanism of action of broad spectrum antibiotics, and also how it differs from narrow spectrum and extended spectrum antibiotic, and also the example and dosage. And you should remember that this is used as empirical therapy. There is chance of multiple drug resistance, and also it will kill the natural microbiomes present in your GIT. So care should be taken. And before starting this empirical therapy, you should remember to send swab, either for culture sensitivity or culture, whatever it is, to the microbiology lab, so that you get a definitive therapy you get the isolated pathogen for a deferred therapy. Okay, thank you.